machine mounting to the welkin's cheek dashes the fire out. Oh, I have suffered with those that I saw suffer. A brave vessel, no doubt some noble creature in her, dashed all to pieces. Oh, the cry did knock against my very heart. Poor souls, they perished. Had I been any god of power, I would have sunk the sea within the earth, or ere it should the good ship so have swallowed, and the frothing souls within
her... Be collected! No more amazement. Tell your piteous heart there's no harm done.
Oh, woe the day!
No harm! I have done nothing but in care of thee. Thee, my dear one. Thee, my daughter, who art ignorant of what thou art, not knowing of whence I come, nor that I am more greater than Prospero, master of a full poor cell. Am I no greater father?
Mortimer did never meddle with my thoughts.
'Tis time I should inform thee further. Lend thy hand and pluck my magic garment from me. Why there, my heart. Wipe thy thou tears. Have comfort. And the direful spectacle of the wreck, which touched the very virtue of compassion in thee, I have, with such provision in mine art, so safely ordered that there is no soul, no, not so much perdition as an hair, but to any creature on the vessel, that thou heardst cry, that thou sawst sink. Sit down. For thou must now know further.
You have often begun to tell me what I am, but stopped, left me to a bootless inquisition, concluding stay not yet.
The hour is now come. The very minute bids thee ope thy ear, obey. Be attentive. Canst thou remember a time before we came unto this cell? I do not think thou canst, because then thou wast not out 3 years old.
Certainly, sir, I can.
By what? By any other house or person? Of anything the image tell me that hath kept with thy remembrance?
It's rather like a dream than an assurance my remembrance warrants. Had I not once 4 or 5 women that tended me?
Thou hadst, and more, Miranda. And how is it that this lives in thy mind? What seest thou else in the dark, backward and abysm of time? Thou rememberest aught ere thou camest here, how thou camest here, thou mayest?
That I do not.
20 years since, Miranda. 20 years. Thy father was the Duke of Milan, and the Prince of Power.
Sir, and not you my father?
Thy mother was a piece of virtue, and she said thou was my daughter. And thy father was Duke of Milan, and thou his only heir and princess. No worse issued.
Holy. What foul play had we that we came from this? What blessed was it we did?
Both, my girl. By foul play, as thou sayest, were we heaved thence, but blessedly hope hither.
My heart bleeds to think of the team that I have turned you to, which is from my remembrance. Please you further.
My brother, and thy uncle, called Antonio, I pray thee mark me, that a brother should be so perfidious. He whom next thyself of all the world I loved, and to him put the manage of my state. As at that time, through all the signories, it was the first, and Prospero the prime duke, being so reputed in dignity, and for the liberal arts without a parallel, those being all my study. The government I cast upon my brother, and to my state grew stranger, being transported and wrapped in secret studies. Thy false uncle, dost attend me?
Sir, most heedfully.
Being once perfected how to grant suits, how to advance, who to deny and who to trash for overtopping. You created the creatures that were mine, I say. Changed them. Or else new formed them, having the key of both officer and office. Set all hearts in the state to what tune pleased his ear. That now he was the ivy that has hid my princely trunk. Sucked my verdure out on't. Thou tens not.
Oh, good sir, I do.
I pray thee mark me. I thus, neglecting worldly ends, all dedicated to closeness and the bettering of my mind, with that which, by being so retired, or prized, or popular rate, in my false brother awaked an evil nature, and my trust, like a good parent, to beget of him a falsehood in its contrary as great as was my trust, which was indeed without limit, a confidence sans bound. He being thus lauded, not only with what my revenue yielded, but what my power might else exact, as one who, having into truth by telling of it, made such a sinner of his memory to credit his own lie, he did believe, indeed, he was the Duke, out of the substitution and executing the outward face of royalty with all prerogative. Dost thou hear?
Your tale, sir, would cure deafness.
To have no screen between this part he played and him he played it for, he needs would be absolute minimum. Me, poor man, my library would dukedom large enough. Temporal royalties he thinks me now incapable. Confederate, so dry he was for sway with the King of Naples. Give him annual tribute, do him homage, subject his coronet to his crown, and bend the dukedom yet unbowed to most ignoble stooping.
Oh, the heavens!
Oh, mark the condition and the event, and tell me if this might be a brother.
I should sin to think but nobly of my grandmother. Good wombs have borne bad sons.
Now the condition. This King of Naples, being an enemy to me inveterate, hearkens my brother's suit. Which is that he, in lieu of the premises of homage and I know not how much tribute, should presently extirpate me and mine out of the dukedom and confer fair Milan with all the honours on my brother, whereon a treacherous army levied. One midnight, fated for the purpose, did Antonio open the gates of Milan. And in the dead of darkness, the ministers for the purpose hurried thence, me and thy crying self.
Alack, for pity. I not remembering how I cried out then, will cry it all over again. 'Tis a hint that brings mine eyes to it.
Here a little further, and then I'll bring thee to this present business that now's upon us, without the which my story were most impertinent.
Wherefore did they not that hour destroy us?
Well demanded, wench. My tale provokes that question. Dear, they durst not. So dear the love my people bore me, nor paint a mark so bloody on the business, but with colours fairer painted their foul ends. In few, they hurried us aboard a bark, carried us some leagues to sea, and there prepared a rotten carcass of a butt, not rig nor tackle, sail nor mast, they rats instinctively had quit it. There they hoist us, the cry to the sea that roared at us, the sigh to the winds whose pity, sighing back again, did us but loving wrong.
Look, what trouble was I then to you?
Oh, a cherubim thou wast that did preserve me. Thou didst smile, infused with a fortitude from heaven, and I had decked the sea with drops full salt under my burden groaning, which raised in me an undergoing stomach to bear up against what should ensue.
How came we ashore?
By providence divine. Some food we had, and some fresh water, that a noble Neapolitan, Gonzalo, out of his charity, being then appointed master of the design, did give us, with rich garments, linen, stuff, and necessaries which since have steadied much. So, his gentleness, knowing that I loved my books. He furnished me from my own library with volumes that I prize above my dukedom.
Would I might but ever see that name.
Here I arise. Sit still. And hear the last of our sea sorrow. Here, on this island we arrived, and here have I, thy schoolmaster, done thee more profit than other princes can, that have more time for vainer hours and tutors not so careful.
Heaven thank you for it. And now, pray you, sir, for still 'tis beating on my mind. Your reason for raising the sea storm.
No, thus far forth. Thy accident, most strange, bounteous fortune. Now, my good lady, hath mine enemies brought to this shore. And by my prescience, I find that my zenith doth depend upon a most auspicious star, whose influence, if now I court not but omit, my fortune shall ever after droop. Here cease more questions. Thou art inclined to sleep. 'Tis a good dullness, and give it way. I know thou canst not choose. Come away, servant. I'm ready now. Come, approach, my Ariel, come.
All hail, great master, grave sir, hail. I come to answer thy best pleasure, be it to fly, to swim, to dive into the fire, to ride on the cold clouds, to thy strong bidding, task Ariel and all her quality.
Hast thou, spirit, performed to task the tempest that I met thee?
To every article. I boarded the king's ship, now on the beak, now on the waist, on the deck, in every cabin I flamed amazement. Sometime I divide and burn in many places, on the topmasts, the yards and bowsprit, when I flame distinctly, then meet and join. Jove's lightnings, the precursors of the dreadful thundercaps, more momentary and sight outrunning were not. The fires and cracks of sulphurous roaring, the most mighty Neptune seemed to besiege and make her bold waves tremble. Yea, her dread trident shake.
Yeah, my brave spirit, who was so brave, so constant, that this coil should not infect his wisdom.
Not a soul, but felt a fever of the mad, and played some tricks of desperation. All but mariners plunged in the foaming brine, then all afire, and quit the vessel, then all afire with me. The king's son, Ferdinand, with hair upstaring, then like reeds, then hair, was the first man that leaped, cried, hell is empty and all the devils are here.
Oh, that's my spirit. But was not this nigh shore?
Close by, my master.
But are they aerial safe?
Not a hair perished. On their sustaining garments, not a blemish, but fresher than before. And as thou bad'st me, in troops have I dispersed them about the isle. The king's son have I landed by himself, whom I left cooling of the air, with sighs in an odd angle of the isle, his arms in the sad knot.
Of the king's ship, the mariners, say how thou hast disposed, and all the rest of this fleet?
Safely in harbour is the king's ship, in the deep nook where once thou called'st me up at midnight to fetch dew from the still-vexed bear moose, there she's hid. The mariners all under hatches stowed, who, with a charm joined to their suffered labours, I now have left asleep. And for the rest of the fleet, which I dispersed, they now have met again, and are on the Mediterranean float, bound sadly home for Naples, believing that they saw the kingship wrecked, and his great person perish.
Yeah. Ariel, thy charge exactly is performed. There's more work to do. What's the time of the day?
Past the mid-season.
Yeah, at least two glasses. The time twixt six and now must by us both be spent most preciously.
Is there more toil? Since thou dost give me pains, let me remember thee what thou dost promise, which is not yet performed me.
How now, moody? What is thou canst demand?
My liberty.
What? Before the time be up, no more.
I prithee, Remember, I have done thee worthy service, told thee no lies, made thee no mistakings, served without all grudge or grumblings. Thou didst promise to bait me a full year.
Hast thou forgot from what torment I did free thee?
No, sir.
Thou hast! And thinks it much to tread the ooze of the salt deep, to run before the sharp wind of the north, to do me business in the veins of the earth when it is baked with frost?
I do not, sir.
Oh, thou liest, malignant thing. Hast thou forgot the foul witch Sycorax that with age and envy was bent into a hoop?
No,
hast thou
sir.
Forgot her, eh?
No, sir.
Thou hast. Where was she born? Speak, tell me.
Sir, in Argier.
Oh, was she so? I must once in a month recount what thou hast been, which thou forgetst. This foul witch, Sycorax, for mischiefs manifold and torments terrible to enter human hearing, was banished, thou knowest, from Argiers. For one thing she did, they would not take her life. Is not this true?
Aye, sir.
This blue-eyed hag was hither brought with child, and here was left by the sailors. Then was thou, my slave, as thou reports thyself, her servant, and for thou wast a spirit too delicate to act her earthy and abhorred commands, refusing her high hest, she did confine thee, with the help of her more powerful ministers, and in her most unmitigable rage, into a cloven pine, within which rift, imprisoned thou did painfully remain, a score of years, within which space she died, and left thee there, to vent thy groans as fast as mill wheels strike. Then was this isle, save for the son that she did litter here, a feckled whelp, hag born, not honoured with a human kind.
Yes, Caliban, her son.
Dull thing, I say so. Yes, that Caliban that now I keep in service. Thou best knowest the torment I did find thee in. My groans would make wolves howl. Was a penetrate the breasts of ever angry bears. Was a torment to lay upon the damned, which Sycorax could not again undo. It was mine art, when I arrived and heard thee, that made gape the pine and let thee out.
I thank thee, master.
If thou murmurest more, I'll rend an oak and peg thee in its knotty entrails till thou hast howled away a dozen winters.
Pardon, master. I will be correspondent to command and do my spiriting gently.
Do so, and in 2 days I will discharge thee.
That's my noble master. What shall I do? Say what? What shall I do?
Go make thyself like a nymph of the sea, not subject to any sight but thine and mine, invisible to all eyeballs else. Go take this shape and hither come in it. Go hence with diligence.
I go.
Awake, dear heart. Awake. Thou hast slept well.
Awake.
Strangeness of your tale has left heaviness in me.
Shake it off. Come on. Well, visit Caliban, my slave. Maybe he yields us kind answer.
'Tis a villain, sir, I do not love to look on.
But as 'tis, we cannot miss him. He does make our fire, and he's in our wood, serves in offices that profit us. But ho, slave, Caliban, thou earth, thou speak.
There's wood enough with thee.
Come forth, I say, there's other business for thee. What, tortoise, when? Poisonous slave got by the devil himself upon thy wicked dam. Come forth!
As wicked Jew as e'er my mother brushed with raven's feather from unwholesome fen. Drop on you both. A southwest blown ye in bliss you will o'er.
For this be sure, tonight thou shalt have cramps. Side stitches, to pen thy breath up. Urchins shall for the vast of the night, that they may work all exercise on thee. Thou shalt be pinched as thick as honeycombs, and each pinch more stinging than the bees that made them.
I must eat my dinner. This island's mine, by Sycorax my mother, which thou takest from me. When thou camest first, thou strokest me and madest much of me, wouldst give me water with berries and teach me how to name the bigger light, and how the less that burn by day and night. And then I loved thee, and showed thee all the qualities of the isle, the fresh springs, the brine pits, barren place and fertile. Cursed be I that did so. All the charms of Sycorax, toads, beetles, bats, light on you. For I am all the subjects that you have, which first was mine own king. And here you stye me in this hard rock, whilst you do keep me from the rest of the island.
Most lying slave, whom stripes may move, but not kindness. I treated thee, filth that thou art, with loving care. Lodged thee in mine own cell, till thou didst seek to violate the honour of my child.
Oho, oho, would it have been done? Thou didst prevent me. I had people douse this isle with calabans.
Abhorred slave! That any print of goodness will not take, being capable of all ill. I pitied thee, took pains to make thee speak, taught thee each hour one thing or other, when thou didst not, savage, know thine own meaning, but to gabble like a thing most brutish, I endowed thy purposes with words that made them known. Thy vile race, thou didst learn, had that in it which good natures could not afford to be with. Therefore art thou deservedly confined within this rock, that deserved more than a prison.
You taught me language, and my profit on it is, I know how to curse. The red plague rid you for learning me your language.
Hence, hagseed, fetch us in fuel, and be quick, thou best, to answer other business. Strikest thou malice? If thou neglect'st, or does unwillingly what I command, I'll rack thee with aged cramps, fill thy bones with aches, and make thee roar so beasts will tremble at thy din.
No, pray thee. I must obey. His art is of such power, it would control my dance god's petty boss, and make a vassal of him.
So say hence!
Where can this music be? In the air of the earth. It sounds no more. I'm sure it waits upon some god of the isle, sitting on a bank, weeping again, the king, my father's wreck. This music came by me upon the waters, allaying both their fury and my passion with its sweet airs. Well, thence have I followed it, or it has drawn me rather. But 'tis gone. No, it begins again.
Nothing of his.
remember my drowned father. This is no mortal business, nor no sound that the earth owes. I hear it now above me.
The fringed curtains of thine eyes advance, and say what thou seest, John.
What is? Is it a spirit? Lord, how it looks about. It carries a brave form, but believe me, sir, it is a spirit.
No, wench. Eats and sleeps and has such senses as we have, such. This gallant that thou seest was in the wreck, but he's something stained with grief. That's beauty's canker, I must say, is a goodly person. He looks about to find his followers.
I might call him a thing divine. But nothing natural I ever saw so noble.
Most sure, the goddess on whom these heirs attend. Vouchsafe my prayer may know if you remain upon this isle, and that you will some good instruction give how I may bear me here. My prime request, which I do last pronounce, is, oh, you wonder, if you be maid or no.
No wonder, sir, but certainly a maid.
My language, heavens, I am the best of them that speak this speech, were I but where 'tis spoken.
How the best? What wert thou if the King of Naples heard thee?
A single thing, as I am now, that wonders to hear thee speak of Naples. He does hear me, and that he does I weep. Myself am Naples, who with mine eyes, never since at the ebb, beheld the king, my father, wrecked.
Alack for mercy.
Yes, faith, and all his lords, the Duke of Milan and his brave son being twain.
Duke of Milan and his more braver daughter could control thee if the time were fit on. The sight, they change eyes. Delicate Ariel, I'll set thee free for this. Sir, a word? I fear you've done yourself some wrong.
I speak to my father so ungently. This is the third man that e'er I saw, the first that e'er I sighed for. Pity move my father to be inclined my way.
Oh, if a virgin and your affection not gone forth, I'll make you the queen of Naples.
Sir, one word more.
They are each in either's power.
But this swift business I must uneasy make, lest too light winning make the prize too light. Sir, I charge that thou attend me. Thou dost hear usurp a name thou owe not, and put thyself upon this island as a spy to win it of me, the Lord of.
No, as I am a man.
There's nothing ill can dwell in such a temple. The fair spirit hath so fair a house. Good things will strive to dwell within it.
Follow me. Speak not for him, he's a traitor. Come on, I'll manacle thy neck and feet together. Sea water shalt thou drink. Thy food will be the fresh brook mussels, withered roots and husks wherein the acorn cradled. Follow.
No. I'll resist such an invitation till mine enemy has more power!
Here, father! Make not to rash trial of him! For he is gentle and not fearful.
What I say, my foot, my tutor! Put up thy sword, traitor! Who makes a show but dares not strike? Thy conscience is so possessed with guilt. Come from thy ward, for I can here disarm thee with this stick and make thy weapon drop!
Beseech you, father!
Hang not upon my garment.
Alack, have pity. I'll be his surety.
Silence, one word more, will make me chide thee, if not hate thee. What? An advocate for an impostor? Hush. Thou thinkst there's no more such shapes as he, having seen but he and Caliban. To most of men, this is a Caliban. And they to he are angels.
My affections then are most humble. I have no ambition to see a goodlier man.
Come on, obey. Thy nerves are in their infancy again and have no vigour in them.
So they are. My spirits, as in a dream, are all bound up. My father's loss, the weakness which I feel, the wreck of all my friends, nor this man's threats to whom I am subdued, are but light to me. Might I but through my prison once a day behold this maid?
It works.
All corners else of the earth, let liberty make use of. Space enough have I in such a prison.
Thou hast done well, fair Ariel. Come on, follow.
Be of comfort. My father's of a better nature, sir, than he appears by speech.
Come on.
This is unwanted now, which came from here.
Thou shalt have the air at Peter. But till then, exactly do what I command.
Aye, to the syllable.
Follow, speak not for him.
Beseech you, sir, be merry. You have cause, so have we all of joy. For our escape is much beyond our loss. A hint of woe is common every day. Some sailor's wife, the master of some merchant, and the merchant have just our theme of woe. But for the miracle, I mean our preservation, few in millions can talk like us. Think wisely, sir, weigh up our sorrow with our comfort. When every grief is entertained, comes to the entertainer, dollar comes to him. So therefore, my lord.
Fie, what a spendthrift he is with his tongue.
I prithee spare.
Here is everything advantageous to life.
True, save means to live.
How lush, lusty looks the grass, how green.
The ground is a tawny indeed.
And the rarity of it is, which is almost beyond credit, is that our garments, as they were drenched by the sea, hold notwithstanding their freshness and glosses, rather than be stained by salt water.
If but one of his pockets could speak, would it not say he lies?
Oh, methinks our garments are as fresh as when we put them on first in Afrique, at the marriage of the king's fair daughter Claribel to the king of Tunis. Sir, we were saying how our garments are as fresh as when we first put them on at the marriage of your daughter, who is now queen. Is not my coat, sir, as fresh as the first day I put it on? Of a sort?
That sort was well fished for.
When I wore it at the first day of your daughter's marriage.
You crammed these words into mine ears against the stomach of my sense. Would I had never married my daughter there. For coming thence, my son is lost, and in my rage she too, who is so far from Italy removed, I ne'er again shall see her. O thou, mine heir of Naples and of Milan, what strange fish hath made his meal on thee?
Had I plantation of this isle, my lord?
He'd sow it with nettle seed.
Had I plantation of this isle, and the king were on't, what would I do? I would by contraries execute all things, for no kind of traffic would I admit. No name of magistrate, letters should not be known, riches, poverty. Ah, and the use of services, none. Contract, succession, bond, bound of land, tilth, vineyard, none. And no use of metal. No use of metal, oil, wine, and no occupation. All men, idols all. And women too. But innocent and pure. No sovereignty. All things of a common nature would bring forth and produce without sweat, endeavour, without treason, felony, sword, pike, knife, gun, or any metal would I have use of. But nature should bring forth of its own kind all foison, all abundance, to feed my innocent people. With such perfection, sir, I would govern to excel the golden age.
Long live Gonzalo!
Prithee no more. Thou dost talk nothing to me.
Pray, good lord, be not angry.
No, I'll warrant you not. I'll not adventure my discretion so weakly. Will you laugh me asleep, sir? For I am very heavy.
Go sleep and hear us.
So soon asleep. I wish mine eyes would, with themselves, shut up my thoughts. I find they are inclined to do so.
I'll guard your person while you take your rest. and watch your safety.
Thank you. Wondrous heavy. Wondrous heavy.
It is the quality of the climber. My spirits are nimble. They fell together all as by consent. They dropped as by a thunderstroke. Look how well my garments sit upon me. Much fitter than before. My brother's servants were then my fellows. Now they are my men. And when I raise my hand,
why art thou drawn? Wherefore this ghastly looking?
What is the matter?
Whilst I stood here securing your repose, I heard a hollow burst of bellowing like bulls, or rather lions. Did not wake you? It struck mine ear most terribly.
I heard nothing.
Oh, 'twas a din to fright a monster's ear, to make an earthquake, sure. It was the roar of a whole herd of lions.
Heard you this, Gonzalo?
Upon my honor, sir, I heard a humming, and a strange one too, which did awaken me. I shake you, sir, and I cried. And when mine eyes opened, I saw you with a weapon drawn. There was a noise, and verily, 'tis best we stand upon our guard, so well, then we quit this place.
Lead off this ground, and let's make further search for my poor son.
Heaven protect him from this beast.
Lead away.
For I is ashore on the island.
My lord shall know what I have done. So, king, go on safely to meet thy son.
All the infections that the sun sucks up from bogs, fens, flats, on Prosperfall, and make him by Ichmeal a disease. The spirits hear me, and yet I needs must curse. But they'll nor pinch, fright me with urchin shows, pitch me in the mire, nor will they lead me out of my way in the dark like a firebrand, unless he bid them. But for every trifle are they set upon me, sometime like apes, that now and chatter at me and after bite me, then like hedgehogs, that lie tumbling in my barefoot way and mount their pricks at my footfall. Sometime am I all wound with adders, who with cloven tongues do hiss me into madness. No, here comes a spirit of his, and to torment me for bringing wood in slowly, I'll fall flat, perchance he will not bite me.
There's neither bush nor shrub to bear off any weather at all. And another storm brewing. Oh, I hear it sing of the wind. And the same black cloud. A huge one. It's like a foul bombard that should shed as liquor. If it would thunder as it did before, I know not where to hide my head. And the same black cloud cannot choose but fall by pale fools. What have we here? Man or a fish? Dead or alive? It sure smells like a fish. A very ancient fish-like smell, not of the newest poor John. Strange fish. Were I in England as once I was, and had but this fish painted, not a holiday fool there but would give me a piece of silver. There this beast would make a man. Any monster there makes a man. Where they will not give a doit to relieve a lame beggar, they'll lazy out 10 to see a dead Indian. Strange though. Legged like a man. Fins like arms, and warmer, my troth. Do let loose my opinion, for it can be held no longer. This is no fish, but an islander who hath lately been struck by thunderstroke. As the storm is coming in, my best make is to hide under his gabardine. There is no other shelter hereabouts. Or as reacquaints a man with strange bedfellows. Here shrouded, till the dregs of the storm be past.
I shall no more to see. Here shall I die ashore. This is a very scurvy tune to sing at a man's funeral. But here's my comfort. The master, the swabber, the boatswain and I, the gunner and his mate loved Moll and Meg and Marion and Marjorie, but none of us cared for Kate. For she had a tongue with a tang, would cry to a sailor, go hang. She loved not the savour of tarn or root pitch, yet a tailor might scratch her where'er she did it. Then to sea, boys, and let her go hang. This is a very scurvy tune, too. But here's my comfort.
Do not torment me, oh!
What's the matter? Have we devils here? Do you put tricks upon us with savages and men of end, huh? I have not scaped drowning to be afeard now of your four legs. For it hath been said, as proper a man as ever went on four legs cannot make him give ground. And it shall be said so again while Stefano breathes his nostrils.
The spirit torments me. Oh.
This is some monster of the isle with four legs who hath got, as I take it, an ague. How the devil should he learn our language? I will give him some relief, if it be but for that, if I can recover him and keep him tame, and then get to Naples with him. He's a present for any emperor that's ever trod on neat's leather.
Do not torment me, prithee. I'll bring my wood home faster.
He's in his fit now, and does not talk after the wisest. He shall taste of my bottle. If he have never drunk wine afore, we'll go near to remove his fit. If I can recover him and keep him tame, I'll not take too much for him. No, he shall pay for him that hath him, and that soundly.
It does me yet but little hurt. Thou wilt anon. I know it by thy trembling. Now prosper works upon thee.
Come, on your ways. Open your mouth. Here is that which will give language to you, cat. Open your mouth. This will shake your shaking, I can tell you, and that soundly. Oh, you cannot tell who's your friend. Open your chaps again.
I didn't know that voice. It should be. Oh, but he is drowned, and these are devils. Defend me.
Four legs and two voices. A most delicate monster. His forward voice is now to speak well of his friend. His backward voice is to utter foul speeches and to detract. If all the wine in my bottle will recover him, I will help his ague. Come! Amen. I will pour some in thy other mouth.
Stefano?
Doth thy other mouth call me? Mercy, mercy! This is a devil and no monster. I will leave him. I have no long spoon.
Stefano, if thou be Stefano, touch me and speak to me. Be not afeard of thy good friend Trinculo.
Well, if thou beest Trinculo, come forth. I will pull thee by thy lesser legs. If any be Trinculo's legs, these are they.
Oh,
so indeed. How camest thou to be the siege of this moon calf?
I took him to be killed with a thunderstroke. But art thou not drowned, Stefano? I hope now thou art not drowned. And is the storm overblown? I hid me hid under the dead moon calf's gabardine for fear of the storm. And art thou living, Stefano? Oh, Stefano, do Neapolitan escape!
Prithee, do not turn me about. My stomach is not constant.
These be fine things, if they be not sprites. That's a brave god and fair celestial looker. I will kneel to him.
How didst thou escape? How camest thou hither? Swear by this bottle how thou camest hither. I escaped upon a butt of sack, which the sailors heaved overboard, by this bottle, which I made of the bark of a tree with my own hands since I was cast ashore.
I'll swear myself upon that bottle to be thy true subject, for the liquor is not earthly.
Here, swear then how thou escapest.
Swam ashore, man, like a duck. I can swim like a duck. I'll be sworn.
Yeah, swear to that. Kiss the book. Though thou can swim like a duck, thou art made like a goose.
Oh, Stefano, hast any more of this?
The whole butt, man. My cellar is in a rock by the seaside where my wine is hid. How now, moon calf? How does thine ague?
Hast thou not dropped from heaven?
Out of the moon, I do assure thee. I was the man in the moon when the time was.
I've seen thee in her, and to adore thee. My mistress showed me thee and thy dog and thy bush.
Swear to that. Kiss the book. I will furnish it anon with new content, swear.
By this good light. This is a very shallow monster. I have feared of him? A very weak monster. The man of the moon? Most poor, credulous monster. Well drawn, in good sooth, monster.
I'll show thee every fertile inch of the island, and I will kiss thy foot. I pray thee, be my god.
This life, most ridiculous. Most perfidious drunken monster. When his god's asleep, he'll rob his bottle.
I will kiss thy foot. I will swear myself thy subject.
Well, come then, down and swear.
Shall laugh myself to death at this puppy-headed monster. Most scurvy monster I could find it in me to beat him.
Come, kiss.
Monsters and drink. An abominable monster.
I'll show thee the best springs. I'll pluck thee berries. I'll fish for thee and get thee wood enough. Plague upon the tyrant that I serve. I'll bear him no more sticks, but follow thee, thou wondrous man.
Most ridiculous monster. Make a wonder of a poor drunkard.
I prithee, let me bring thee where crabs grow, and I with my long nails will dig thee pig nuts. Show thee a jay's nest, and instruct thee how to snare the nimble marmoset. I'll bring thee to clustering filberts, and sometimes I'll get thee young scandals from the rock.
I prithee now lead the way, without any more talking. Trinkler, the king and all else company being drowned, we shall inherit here. Here. Bear my bottle. We shall fill him by and by again.
Farewell, master. Farewell.
A howling monster. Drunken monster.
No more dams I'll make for fish, nor fetch and firing, and requiring, nor scrape trencher, nor wash dish. Ban, ban, Caliban! Has a new master got a new man? Freedom. Freedom.
Freedom.
Hey, oh, brave Freedom. Monster! Lead the way!
There be some sports, a painful, but their labour to lighten them sets off. Some kinds of baseness are nobly undergone, Most poor matters point to rich ends. This, my mean task, would be as heavy to me as odious. But the mistress which I serve quickens what's dead and makes my labours pleasures. Oh, she is 10 times as gentle as her father's crab. She's composed of harshness. I must remove some thousands of these logs and pile them up upon a sword injunction. My mistress weeps when she sees me work. Says such baseness had never like executor. I forget. But these sweet thoughts do even refresh my labours. Most busy least when I do it.
Alec, now pray you, work not so hard. I would that the lightning had burnt up those logs you're enjoying to pile. Pray, sit it down and rest. When this burns, it will weep for having wearied you. My father's in his study. Rest yourself. He's safe for these 3 hours.
Most dear mistress, the sun will set before I shall discharge what I must strive to do.
If you'll sit down, I'll bear your logs the while. Pray, give me that, I'll carry it to the pile.
No! Precious creature, I had rather crack my sinews, break my back, than you should such dishonour undergo while I sit lazy by.
It would become me as well as it does you, and I should do it with more ease, for my goodwill is to it, and yours it is against.
Poor worm, thou art infected, this visitation shows it.
You look weary.
No, noble mistress. Tis fresh morning with me when you are by at night. I do beseech you, chiefly that I might set it in my prayers. What is your name?
Miranda. Oh, my father, I have broke your haste to say so.
Admired Miranda. Indeed, the top of admiration, worth what's dearest to the world. Full many a lady I have eyed with best regard. Many a time the harmony of their tongues hath into bondage brought my too diligent ear. For several virtues have I liked several women. Never any with so full soul, but some defect in her did quarrel with the noblest grace she owed and put it to the foil. But you, oh, you, so perfect and so peerless, are created of every creature's best.
I do not know one of my sex. No woman's face remembered, save for my glass mine own. Nor have I seen more that I may call men than you, good friend. And my dear father. Our features are abroad, I'm skillless of. By my modesty, the jewel in my dower, I would not wish any companion in the world but you. Nor can imagination form a shape to like beside yourself. But I prattle something too wildly, and therein my father's precepts do forget.
I am in my condition a prince, Miranda. I do think a king I would not so. And would no more endure this wooden slavery than suffer the flesh fly below my mouth. Hear my soul speak. The very instant that I saw you, did my heart fly to your service. There resides to make me a slave to it. For your sake am I this patient log man.
Do you love me?
Oh, heaven! Oh, earth! Bear witness to this sound and crown what I profess with kind event if I speak true. If hollowly invert what best has boded me to mischief, I, beyond all limit of what else in the world, do love, prize, honour you.
I am a fool to weep at what I am glad of.
fair encounter of two most rare affections. Heaven rain grace on what may breed between them.
Wherefore weep you? At mine unworthiness, that dare not offer what I desire to give, much less take what I should die to want. This is trifling, and all the more it seeks to hide itself, the bigger bulk it shows. Hence, bashful cunning, it prompt me plain and holy innocence. I am your wife, if you will marry me. If not, I'll die your maid. To be your fellow, you may deny me, but I'll be your servant, whether you will or no.
My mistress, dearest, and I thus humble ever.
My husband, then?
Aye. With a heart as glad as e'er bondage of freedom, here's my hand.
Mine, with my heart in it. And now, farewell, till half an hour here.
A thousand thousand.
As glad of this as they, I cannot be what surprised withal. But my rejoicing at nothing could be greater. Unto my books. For yet, ere supper time, I must perform much business appertaining.
To be brain like us, the state totters.
Drink, servant monster, when I bid thee. Thy eyes are almost set in thy head.
Should they be set out? Be a brave monster indeed if thou sit in his tail.
My man monster hath drowned his tongue and sack. For my part, the sea cannot drown me. I swam, ere I could recover the shore, 35 leagues off and on. By this light, thou shalt be my lieutenant, monster, or my standard.
Your lieutenant, if you list, but he's no standard.
We'll not run, monsieur monster.
We'll go neither, but you'll lie like dogs and say nothing either.
Moon calf, speak once in thy life if thy be'est a good moon calf.
How does thy honour? Let me lick thy shoe. I'll not serve him, he's not valiant.
Thou liest, most ignorant monster, when cased to justle a constable. But that debauched fish, thou, is there ever man a coward who's drank as much sack as I today? Wilt thou tell a monstrous lie, being but half a fish and half a monster?
No! No, how he mocks me! Wilt thou let him, my lord?
Lord, quote he. A monster should be such a natural.
No, no, again. Bite him to death, I prithee.
Trinculo, run into no further danger. Keep a good tongue in thy mouth. If I prove a mutineer, the next tree. The poor monster's my subject, and he shall not suffer indignities.
I thank my noble lord. Wilt thou be pleased to hearken once again to the suit I've made to thee?
Marry, will I kneel and repeat, I shall stand. And so shall Trinculo.
Why, as I have told thee before, I am subject to a tyrant, a sorcerer, that by his cunning hath cheated me of the island.
Thou liest!
Thou liest! Jesting monkey thou! I would my valiant master would destroy thee, I do not lie!
Trinculo, interrupt the monster one word further, and by this hand I will supplant some of your teeth.
I said nothing.
Mum then, and no more. Proceed.
I say, by sorcery he got this isle. From me he got it. If thy greatness will revenge it on him, for I know thou darest, but this thing dare not.
Well, that's most certain.
Thou shalt be lord of it, and I will serve thee.
How now shall this be compassed? Canst thou bring me to the party?
Yea, my lord. I'll yield him thee asleep, where thou mayst knock a nail into his head.
Thou liest, thou canst not.
What a pied ninny is this? Thou scurvy patch. I do beseech thy greatness. Give him blows and take his bottle for him. For when that's gone, he shall drink naught but brine, for I'll not show him where the quick freshers are.
Trinculo, run into no further danger. By this hand, if you interrupt him one word further, I will throw my mercy out the doors and make a stockfish of thee.
Why, I did nothing. I'll stand further off.
Well, didst thou not say he lied?
Thou liest!
Do I so? Well, take thou that. Oh. As thou like this, tell me the lie another time.
Not tell the lie. Your wits and bearing too. Pox in your bottle. Sack and drinking do. Rain on your monster and the devil take your
thing. Proceed with your tale. Stand further off.
Beat him again. After a while I'll beat him too.
Stand further. Come, proceed.
As I have told thee, 'tis a custom with him in the afternoon to sleep. There thou mayst brain him, having first seized his box, or with a log batter his skull, or paunch him with a stake, or cut his weasand with thy knife. Remember first to possess his box, for without them he is but a sot, as I am, nor hath not one spirit to command. They all do hate him as rootedly as I. Burn but his box. He has brave utensils, for so he calls them, which when he has a house he will deck withal. And that most deeply to consider is the beauty of his daughter. He himself calls her a nonpareil. I never saw a woman but only Sycorax my dam, and she, but she far surpasseth the Sycorax, as greatest does least.
Is she so brave, alas?
Aye, my lord, she will become thy bed, I warrant, and bring thee forth brave brood.
Monster, I will kill this man. His daughter and I shall be king and queen, save our graces. And Trinculo and thyself shall be viceroys. Dost thy like the plot, Trinculo?
Excellent.
Give me thy hand. I am sorry I beat thee, but whilst thou livest, keep a good tongue in thy head.
Within this half hour he will be asleep. Wilt thou destroy him then?
Aye, on my honour.
This will I tell my master.
Thou makest me merry. I'm full of pleasure. Let us be jocund. Will you troll the cats you taught me but whiler?
At thy request, monster, I will do reason, any reason. Come on, Trinculo, let us sing.
Flout him and scout him and scout him and flout him. Thought is free!
That's not the churn.
What is this saying?
The tune of our catch, played by the picture of nobody.
Well, if thou be'est a man, come forth. If thou be'est a devil, take us out list.
Oh, mercy, forgive me my sins.
He that dies pays all debts. Mercy upon us, I defy thee!
Art thou afeard?
No, monster, not I.
Be not afeard. This isle is full of noises, sounds, and sweet airs that give delight and hurt not. Sometime a thousand twangling instruments might hum about mine ears, and sometime voices, if I then had waked after long sleep, would make me sleep again. And in dreaming methought the clouds would open up and show riches ready to drop upon me. When I waked, I cried to dream again.
This will prove a brave kingdom to me, for I shall have my music for nothing.
When Prospero is destroyed.
Aye, that will be by and by. I remember the story.
The sound goes that away. Let us follow and later do our work.
Leave, monster, we'll follow. I would I could see this Tabor. He really lays it on.
Wilt come? I'll follow Stefano.
Larkin, sir, I can go no further. My old bones ache. Here is a maze trod indeed through forthrights and meanders. I needs must me rest here by your patience, sir.
Old lord, I cannot blame thee, who am myself attached with weariness to the dulling of my spirits. Sit down and rest. Even here, I will put off my hope and keep it no longer for my flatterer. He is drowned, whom thus we stray to find, and the sea mocks our frustrate search on land. Well, let him go.
I am right glad that he is so out of hope.
What harmony is this? My good friends, hark!
Sweet, marvelous music! Naples, I should report this now. Would they believe me? I saw such islanders. For certes, they are people of this island, for their manners are most gentle kind than of our human civilization, you will find.
Honest
many, no, almost any.
Thou hast spoke well. Some of you there present are very devils.
I cannot too much muse. Such shapes, such gestures, and such sound, expressing, although they want the use of tongue, a kind of excellent, sweet discourse.
Praise in departing.
They vanished strangely.
Faith, sir, fear not. When we were boys, who would believe there were mountaineers? Dew lapped like bulls, whose throats had iron wallets of flesh, or that there was men whose heads stood from their breasts. Oh, and now we find, each putter, 5 to 1, will bring us good warrant of.
I will stand to and seek, although my last. No matter, for I feel the best is past. Brother, my lord the Duke, stand to and do it.
You are 3 men of sense. whom destiny that hath to instrument this lower world and what is in it, the never surfeited sea hath caused the belch up you, and on this island where man doth not inhabit, you, amongst men, being most unfit to live, I have made you mad, and even with such like valour, men hang and drown their proper selves. You're fools! I and my fellows are ministers of fate. The elements of which your swords are tempered may as well wound the loud winds, or with bemocked at stabs kill the still closing waters, as diminish one dowel that's in my plume. My fellow ministers are like invulnerable. If you could hurt, your swords are now too messy for your strengths and will not be uplifted. But remember, for that's my business with you, that you three from Milan did supplant good Prospero, exposed unto the sea that hath requited him and his innocent child, for which foul deed the powers delaying, not forgetting, hath incensed the seas and shores, yea, all the creatures against your peace. Thy son, Alonso, they have bereft. Do pronounce by me lingering perdition, worse than any death can be at once, shall step by step attend you and your ways. Whose wrath's to guard you from, which else on this most desolate isle, else falls upon your heads, is nothing but heart sorrow and a clear life and strength.
Bravely the figure of this harpy as thou performed my aerial. A grace it had, devouring. Of my instruction, nothing hath thou bated in what thou hadst to say. So, with rich life and observation strange, my meaner ministers, their several kinds have done. My high charms work. And these my enemies, all knit up in their distraction, they now are in my power. And it is in this fit I leave them, whilst I visit young Ferdinand, whom they suppose is drowned, and his and mine loved darling.
In the name of something holy, sir, why stand you in that strange stare?
Oh. It is monstrous, monstrous. Methought the billows spoke and told me of it. The winds did sing it to me, and the thunder, that deep and dreadful organ pipe, pronounced the name of Prosper. It did base my trespass. Therefore my son in the ooze is bedded, and I'll seek him deeper than air plummet sounded, and with him there lie muttered.
But one fiend at a time. I'll fight their legions o'er.
These two are desperate. Their great guilt is given to be taken like poison a great time afterwards. It now bites their spirits.
If I have too austerely punished you, look, compensation makes amends. For I have given you here 1/3 of mine own life. That for which I live. Whom once again I tender to thy hand. All thy vexations were but my trials of thy love. And thou hast strangely stood the test. Here, before heaven, I ratify my rich gift. Do not smile at me, Ferdinand, that I boast her of. You shall find she will outstrip all praise and make it halt behind her.
I do believe it, against an oracle.
Then, as my gift and thy acquisition worthily purchased, take my daughter. But if thou shouldst break her virgin knot, afore all sanctimonious ceremonies with full and holy rite be ministered, no sweet aspersion shall the heavens let fall to make this contract grow but barren hate. Sour-eyed disdain and discord shall bestrew the union of your beds with weeds so locally that you shall hate it both. Therefore, take heed. As Hymen's lamp shall light you.
As I hope for quiet days, fair issue and long life, with such love as 'tis now, the murkiest den, the most opportune place, the strongest suggestion our worst genius can, shall never melt mine honour into lust, to take away the edge of that day's celebration. When I shall think, or Phoebus' steeds are foundered, or night kept chained below.
Fairly so. Sit then, and talk with her. She is thine own. My industrious servant, Ariel, come away. Ariel.
What, my potent master? Here I am.
Ariel, thou and thy meaner fellows, your last service worthily did perform, and I must use thee for such another task. Go, bring the rabble, or whom I give thee power, here to this place. Incite them to quick motion, for I must here bestow upon the eyes of this young couple some vanity of mine art. It is my promise, and they do expect it of me.
Presently,
in a twink,
before you can cry, come and go, and breathe twice, and say, so, each one, tripping on his toe, will be here with mop and mow.
Do you love me, master? No.
Dearly, my delicate Ariel. Do not approach until I call thee.
Well, I conceive.
Do thou be true? Do not give dalliance too much the rein. The strongest oath is straw to the fire of the blood. Be more abstemious, or else good night your vow.
I warrant you, sir. The white cold virgin snow upon my heart abates the ardour of my liver.
Well. Come now, Ariel, appear and pertly. No tongue. All eyes. Now silence.
Does my bounteous sister go with me to bless this twain, that they may prosperous be and honored in the issue?
Honor riches, marriage blessing, long continuous. spring bunches growing, plants with goodly birth and bowing. Spring comes to you at the farthest, in the very end of harvest. Scarcity and want shall shun you. Sarah's blessing so is on you.
This is a most majestic vision and harmoniously charming.
May I be bold to think these spirits?
Spirits that by mine art I have from their confines called to enact my present fancy.
Let me live here ever. So rare a wondered father and a wife makes this place paradise.
Oh, sweet, now silence. Juno and Ceres whisper something seriously together. There's something else to do. Hush and be mute, or else our spell is marred. Forgot the vile conspiracy of the beast Caliban and his confederates against mine life. The moment of their plot is nearly come.
This is strange. Your father's in some passion that works him strongly.
Never to this day have I seen him touched with anger so distempered.
You do look, my son, in a moved sort, as if you were dismayed. Be cheerful, sir. Our revels now are ended. And these are actors. As I foretold you, we're all spirits, and are vanished into air, into thin air, like the baseless fabric of this vision. Cloud-capped towers, the gorgeous palaces, the solemn temples, the great globe itself, yea, all which it inherits shall dissolve. Like this insubstantial pageant faded, leave not a rack behind. We are such stuff as dreams are made on, and our little life is rounded with a spell. Sir, I'm vexed. Bear with my weakness. My brain is troubled. Be not dismayed by my infirmity. If it please you, retire into my cell and there repose. A turn or two I'll walk, to still my beating mind.
We wish your peace.
Tell me the thought, Ariel, come.
My thoughts I cleave to, what I pleasure.
Ariel, we must prepare to meet with Caliban.
Aye, my commander.
Well, say again, where did you leave these varlets?
As I told you, sir, they were red hot with drinking, so full of valour that they smote the air for breathing in their faces, beat the ground for kissing of their feet, yet always bending towards their project. Then I beat my tabor, at which, like unbacked colts, they pricked their ears, advanced their eyelids, lifted up their noses as they smelt music. So I charmed their ears, that calf-like they my lowing followed through toothed briars, sharp furzes, pricking goss and thorns, that entered their frail shins. At last I left them in the filthy mantle pool beyond your cell, there dancing up to the chins that the foul lake o'erstunk their feet.
This is well done, my bird. Thy shape invisible, retain thee still. That trumpery in my cell, bring it here, as stale to catch these thieves.
I go.
A devil. A born devil, on whose nature nurture will never stick, on whom my pains, humanely taken, all lost, quite lost. And as with age his body uglier grows, so his mind cankers. A pl- plagued them all, even to roaring.
So is mine. Do you hear that, monster? Should I take a displeasure in you? Look, you!
Thou wert but a lost monster.
Good, my lord. Give me thy favour still. Be patient. The prize I'll bring thee to shall hoodwink this mischance. Therefore, speak softly. All's hushed as midnight yet.
Aye, but to lose our bottles in the pool.
There is not only a disgrace and dishonour in that monster, but an infinite loss.
More to me than my wetting. Yet this is your harmless fairy, monster.
I will fetch my bottle off, though I be over ears in my labour.
I prithee, my king, be quiet. Seest thou here? This is the mouth of the cell. No noise, and enter. Do that good mischief which may make this island thine own forever, and I thy Caliban. For I, thy footlicker,
give me thy hand. I do begin to have bloody thoughts.
O King Stephano! O peer, a worthy Stephano! Look what a wardrobe here is
for
thee!
Let it alone, thou fool, it is but trash!
Oh, monster! You know what belongs to a frippery. O King Stephano!
Put off that crown, Trigolo! I shall have that crown.
Thy grace shall have it.
The dropsy drowned this fool. What do you mean to dote us on such luggage? Let's alone and do the murder first. If he awake, from toe to crown he'll fill us in with pinches. Make us strange stuff.
Be quiet, you monster! Is not this my hat?
I have none on't. We shall lose our time and all be turned to barnacles. Or to apes with foreheads villainous.
Charge my goblins that they grind their joints with dry convulsions, shorten up their sinews with aged cramps, and more pinch-spotted make them than pards at catamounters.
Hark! They roar!
Let them be hunted soundly. Now, at this hour, stand at my mercy, all mine enemies. Shortly, my labor shall be ended. And thou shalt have the air at freedom.
For a while. Follow. Do me service. Gather to a head. My charms crack not. My spirits obey. Time goes upright with his carriage. How's the day?
On the sixth hour, at which time, my lord, you said our work would cease.
I did say so when first I raised the tempest. Say, spirit, how fares the king and his followers?
Confined together in the same fashion as you gave in charge, just as you left them. All prisoners, sir, in the lime grove that weather fends your cell. They cannot budge till your release. All three, brim full of sorrow and dismay. But chiefly him you term, sir, the good old Lord Gonzalo. His tears run down his beard like winter's drops from eaves of reeds.
Your charm so strongly works them that if you now beheld them, your affections would become tender.
You think so, Spirit?
Mine would, sir, were I human.
Mine shall. As thou that art but air, a touch, a feeling of their afflictions, shall not myself, one of their kind, relish all as strongly, passion as they, be kindlier moved than thou art. Though with their high wrongs I am struck to the quick, yet with my nobler reason, against my fury, do I take part. The rarer action is in virtue than in vengeance. They being penitent, the sole drift of my purpose extends not a frown further. Go release them, Ariel. My charms are break. Their senses are restore, and they shall be themselves.
I'll fetch them, sir.
The elves of hills, brooks, standing lakes, and groves, and he that on the sands with printless foot do chase the ebbing Neptune, and to fly him when he comes back, the dammy pockets, that by moonshine do the green sour ringlets make, whereof the yew knot bites, and you whose pastime is to make midnight mushrooms, that rejoice to hear the solemn curfew, by whose aid, weak masters though ye be, I have bedimmed the noontide sun, call forth the mutinous winds, and twixt the green sea and the azured vault set roaring war. To the dread rattling thunder have I given fire, and rifted Jove's stout oak with his own bolt. Have I made shake, and by the spurs plucked up the pine and cedar. Graves at my command have waked their sleepers, oped and let them forth by my so potent art. But this rough magic I here abjure. When I have required some heavenly music, which even now I do, to work mine end upon their senses, that this eerie charm is for, I'll break my staff, bury it certain fathoms in the earth, deeper than did ever plummet sound, I'll drown my comforter to an unsettled fancy, cure thy brains. Now useless, boiled within thy skull. Stand. You are spell stopped. Holy Gonzalo, honorable man, mine eyes, even sociable to the show of thine, fall felony drops. The charm dissolves apace. The morning steals upon the night, melting the darkness, so their rising senses begin to chase the ignorant fumes that mantle their clearer reason. But Gonzalo, my true preserver, and the loyal sir to him thou followest, thy graces I will pay back with deed and word. Most cruelly didst thou, Alonso, use me and my daughter. Thee, brother mine, that entertained ambition, expelled remorse and nature, flesh and blood, whose inward pinches therefore are most strong, would here have killed your king. I do forgive thee, unnatural though thou art. There's not a one of them that yet sees me or would know me. Ariel, bring the hat and rapier from my cell. They will discase me, and myself present as I was sometime, Milan. Quickly, Spirit, thou shalt ere long be free.
Where the
bee socks, yes, I find, in a cowslip bell I lie. There I couch when owls do cry. On the bat's back I do fly after summer merrily. Merrily, merrily shall I live now. Under the blossom that hangs on the bough.
Aye, that's my dainty Ariel. I shall miss thee. Thou shalt have freedom. So.
All torment, trouble, wonder, and amazement inhabit here. Some earthly power guide us from this fearful country.
Behold, Sir King, the wronged Duke of Milan, Prospero. For more assurance that a living prince now speaks with you, I embrace thy body. And to thee and thy company bid a hearty welcome.
Whether thou be'st he or no, or some enchanted trifle to abuse me as late I have been, I not know. Thy pulse beats as of flesh and blood. And since I saw thee, the affliction of my mind amends, with which I fear madness held me. This must crave, and if this be at all, a most strange story. Thy dukedom I resign, and do entreat thou pardon me my wrongs. But how should Prospero be living and be here?
First, noble friend, let me embrace thine age, whose honor cannot be measured nor confined.
Whether this be or be not, I'll not swear.
You still do taste some subtleties of the isle, which will not let you believe things certain. Welcome, friends both. To you, most wicked sir, whom to call brother would even infect my mouth. I do forgive thy rankest fault, all of them, and require of thee my dukedom, which perforce I know thou must restore.
If thou beest prosperous, give us particulars of thy preservation, how thou hast met us here, who 3 hours since were wrecked upon this shore where I have lost. How sharp the point of that remembrance is, my dear son, Ferdinand.
I am woe to it, sir.
Irreparable is the loss, and patience says it
is past her cure.
I rather think you have not asked her help.
Who?
Of her sad grace, for the like loss, I have her sovereign aid, and rest myself content.
You the like loss?
As great to me, as late, and supportable to make the dear loss, if I means much weaker than you may call to comfort you, for I have lost my daughter.
A daughter? Oh, heavens, that they were living both in Naples, the king and queen there. That they were, I wish myself, were mudded in that oozy bed where my son lies. When did you lose your daughter?
In this last tempest. But I perceive these lords at this encounter do perceive that they scarce do think their eyes do offices of truth. Their words are natural breath. But howsoe'er you have been jostled from your senses, know for certain that I am Prospero, and that very duke which was hoisted fed from Milan, who, most strangely, upon this shore where you were wrecked, was landed to be the lord on't. But yet, no more of this. It is a chronicle for day by day, and not the relation for a breakfast, nor yet befitting a first meeting. Sir, you are welcome. This cell's my court, here are by few attendants, and subjects none abroad. My dukedom, since you have given me back again, I will requite thee with as good a thing, at least bring forth a wonder that will comfort you as much as me my dukedom.
Sweet lord, you play me false.
No, my dearest love, I would not for the world.
Yes, for a score of kingdoms you should wrangle, and I should call it fair play.
If this prove a vision of the island, one dear son shall I twice lose.
Though seas threaten, they are merciful. I have cursed them without cause.
Now all the blessings of a glad father compass thee about. Arise, and say how thou camest here.
Oh, wondrous! How many goodly creatures are there here? How beauteous mankind is! Oh, brave new world that has such people in it.
It's new to you.
What is this maid with whom thou wast at play? Your else acquaintance cannot be 3 hours. Is she the goddess that hath severed us and brought us thus together?
Well, sir, she is mortal. But by immortal providence, she's mine. I chose her when I could not ask my father for his advice, nor thought I had one. Oh, she is daughter to this famous Duke of Milan, of whom so often I have heard renown, but never saw before, of whom I have received a second life, and second father this lady makes him to me.
I am hers. But oh, how oddly will it sound that I must ask my child forgiveness.
Oh, there, sir, stop. Let us not burden our remembrance with the heaviness that's past.
I have inly wept, or should have spoke ere this. Look down, you god, and on this loving couple drop a blessed crown. For it is you who have chalked the way forth and brought us hither.
I say amen, Gonzalo.
Where's Milan? Trust from Milan that his issues should become kings of Naples. Oh, rejoice! Beyond a reasonable joy, and set it down with gold and lasting pillars. In one voyage, did Clarabel her husband find in Tunis, and Ferdinand her brother found a wife when he himself was lost. Prospero his dukedom on a poor isle, and all of us ourselves when no man was his own.
Give me your hands. That grief and sorrow still embrace his heart that doth not wish you joy.
Be it so, amen.
Sir, all this service have I done since I left?
My tricksy spirit.
Was it well done?
Bravely, my diligence, thou shalt be free.
This is as strange a maze as e'er men trod, and there is in this business something more than nature was ever conduct of. Some oracle must rectify our knowledge.
Sir, my liege, do not infest your mind with beating on the strangeness of this business. At picked leisure, which shall be shortly, a single I'll resolve thee, which you shall see is probable, of all the happened accidents. Till then, be cheerful, and think of all things well. Ariel, set Caliban and his confederates free. Untie the spell. Sir, how fares my noble lord? There are yet missing of your company a few odd lads that you remember not.
Let every man shift all the rest, and let no man take care for himself for all his misfortune. Courage, old bully monster!
These be true spies which I wear in my head, then here's a goodly sight.
Oh, said the boss, these be brave spirits indeed. How fine my master is! I'm afraid he'll chastise me.
Very like. One of them is a plain fish and no doubt mackerel.
Do I see the badges of these men, my lords? And say they be true. This misshapen knave, his mother was a witch, and a strong one too, that could control the moon, make flows and ebbs, and deal in her command without her power. These three have robbed me. And this demi-devil, for he is a bastard one, plotted with them to take my life. Two of these fellows you must know and own. This thing of darkness, I acknowledge mine.
I shall be pinched to death.
Is not this Stefano my drunken butler? And Trinculo is reeling ripe. Where should they find this grand liquor that hath gilded them? How camest thou in this pickle?
Been in such a pickle since I saw you last. Hear me, we'll never out of my bones.
Oh, touch not me, for I am not Stefano, but a cramp.
Thou wouldst be king of the isle, sirrah.
I would be a sore one, then.
And this is a stranger creature as ere I laid eyes on.
He is as misproportioned in his manners as in his shape. Sirrah. Go to my cell. Take your companions with you. As you look for my pardon, trim it handsomely.
Aye, that I will. And I'll be wise hereafter and seek for grace. What a thrice double ass was I to take this drunkard for a god and worship this dull fool.
Go to away. Sir. I invite your highness and your train to my poor cell, there to take your rest for this one night. The which, in part, I shall waste with such discourses, and I no doubt will make the time go fast. The story of my life and the particular accidents gone by since first I came to this isle. And in the morn, bring me to thy ship, and so to Naples, where I have hope to see solemnized the nuptials of these, our dear beloved. And then retire me to my Milan, where every third thought shall be my grave.
I long to hear the story of your life, which must take the ear strangely.
I'll deliver all, and promise thee calm seas, auspicious gales, and sail so expeditious that you shall catch your royal fleet afar off. Ariel. That's thy charge. And then to the elements be free. And fare thee well. Pray you, draw near.
Thank you.
charms are all o'erthrown. Strength I have's mine own, which is most faint. Now 'tis true, I must be here confined by you, or sent to Naples. Let me not. Now I have my dukedom got, and pardon the deceiver, dwell on this bare island by your spell, and release me from my bands with the use of your good hands, gentle breath of yours. My sails must fill, or else my project fails, which was to please. Now I want spirits to enforce, art to enchant. My ending is despair, unless I be relieved by prayer that pierces so that it assaults mercy itself and frees all faults. As you from crimes would pardoned be, let your indulgence set me free.